Today I'm going to test out a light pollution filter for astrophotography and see if it's any good. The company Freewell sent me a light pollution filter last autumn, but I wanted to wait until the Milky Way season to get a few different shots with it. Now, I'm a wide field astrophotographer. I don't have a telescope, and even though I've done some deep space objects, I mostly go for wide field Milky Way shots. Now, just before we were stopped from going out and we got grounded, the Milky Way started, and I managed to get to a bortle 3 location. We did have some small villages to the south, which put a little bit of light pollution on the horizon, and then to the north, Abu Dhabi glowed in the distance. So I tried a few different test shots to see what this light pollution filter acted like. At $129.99, it is one of Freewell's more expensive filters. But is it worth it or not? That's the question I want to answer today. It is part of their magnetic range, so once you have the adapter on your lenses, it's just a case of clicking them into place, which I think is fantastic. I already have ND filters, circular polarizers and things like that, and they just click into place, and it is a really good system. I know some of the other brands do this magnetic system as well, so it's well worth getting if you get frustrated with just screwing your filters on and off. The first thing to note is that it has a very blue tint. When I shoot astrophotography, I tend to set my white balance to tungsten. I just like this as a starting point, and as I shoot in RAW, it doesn't really matter. I just don't like seeing the overly yellow shots on the back of my camera when the white balance is set to the daylight setting. Tungsten just makes it look to me almost like it does in real life, but just maybe a little bit bluer. So because of this, when I put this filter on, it did make my photos look so much more bluer than normal. Looking at the unedited RAW files side by side, the one with the filter is the one that's so much bluer, and it really does make the shot a lot different. Also, it has dropped the amount of light coming into the camera by around about half a stop. As for the light pollution, side by side, unedited, it does look like it has controlled it a little bit. But is this just to do with that drop in light coming into the camera, or is it actually helping? First off, let's have a look at these two shots. This is looking east from the location I was at, and there are a couple of different compounds just past the horizon. We also have a phone mast in the shot. So as you can see, we have a mix of light pollution. When editing these, I'll first start with the one without the filter and make the changes I'd normally make. It's not an overly exciting shot, but a good one for comparing these filters. So once I've edited the shot to where I want it, I'll just sync these settings. Now, just in doing this, that blueness really shows. So syncing isn't really an option. So I'll undo that and then edit it from scratch. The first thing to do is get rid of all of that blue color, and then I'll edit it as normal, trying to make the stars pop out of the sky. Now, what I've done is edited them as close as possible to each other, and those sources of light pollution on the horizon really don't look that different at all. If anything, as I started from a much bluer base file, in pushing the white balance slider to the right a lot more, it has emphasized the orange glow to the right a bit more than without the filter. But it's hard to tell the difference apart from this. These next two have a lot more light pollution in them. This is looking southwest towards a closer village with a very distinct orange glow. You can also see Orion just above and to the right of the village. This would always be a tricky one to edit with all of this light pollution, and it almost looks like the sun is starting to break the horizon. But as any of you that have been out shooting the stars before will know, when the sun does start rising, the stars will have disappeared well before this point. Again, with these two, once edited, I got them as close as possible. Due to the blue tone on the filter, when moving the white balance slider to the right, this again emphasized that orange glow on the horizon. However, the glow does look slightly less prominent in the one with that filter. So in this case, it is helping a little bit. After this, I waited for the Milky Way to rise and then tried out the filter again. But this time, I did what I'd normally do in taking a photograph of the Milky Way, and that is put some of the landscape in front of the worst parts of the light pollution. And in this case, at this location, surprise, surprise, it was a sand dune. And this is a good little trick to do if you do have a lot of light pollution on the horizon. Look for a dip in the landscape where you can get much lower and then there's a bit of the landscape that comes a bit higher, and then hide as much of that light pollution as possible with that foreground. Cities and villages can be hundreds of kilometers away, but with the long exposures used in astrophotography, they do still show up, even though they might only be a faint glow on that horizon. So do be aware of this. I also had to stack two shots for these, as the foreground was out of focus when the sky was in focus and vice versa. So I've literally blended two shots together, one of the land and one of the sky, so everything is in focus. On the foreground, I also did some light painting, shining my phone on the foreground from the left for a few seconds. Once again, I edited the one without the filter as normal, balancing the colors to my liking, making the Milky Way and stars pop, and then bringing out the foreground as much as possible. Once I got it to a point where I liked it, I tried syncing it once again. But that blue cast with the one with the filter on really did show up again. So I edited it from scratch. If I switch between these two shots, you can see how different the settings are on my basic sliders, especially the white balance slider. Look how far right I had to pull the temperature slider. This shows how blue the filter actually is. But the question is, did it help? From my experience with this filter, the blue cast didn't worry me too much as I shoot in RAW. And if you're an astrophotographer, you really should be shooting in RAW. But if you do shoot JPEGs, you really would have to get your white balance right before using this filter. And this might be quite tricky in such dark conditions. The one thing that did make a difference is that drop in light. It seemed to be about half a stop, which when doing a 30-second exposure would mean adding 15 seconds more, or with ISO, adding 1,000 or so more to your levels, or using a faster lens. And at night, as there is so little light about in the first place, this drop of half a stop isn't brilliant. So will I be using this in the future? To put it bluntly, probably not. The best thing you can do to get good astrophotography photographs is to get to a good dark location away from any cities or any big sources of light. And if you are thinking of getting one of these to lessen the amount of traveling time that you'd have to do to get to one of these locations, don't. I'd advise spending the money on fuel to get to a better location instead of buying one of these filters. The benefits I got from this filter were so small, if any, that I don't think it's really worth it. I wish it did work, because being able to cut out light pollution and still get the stars and still get the Milky Way would be fantastic. But in reality, when you do cut out that light pollution, you'll also cut out all other forms of light as well, including what you want to photograph. Now, what do you think? Do you use a light pollution filter, and have you been able to get better results than me? Let me know in the comments below. Now, if you like this and want to learn more about astrophotography, click on this video to learn about how to shoot the stars with a crop sensor camera, and this one down here to learn how to shoot the stars with a full frame camera. And if you haven't already, be sure to subscribe for weekly tutorials in photography. I'll see you next time.